This podcast has been brought to you by Voyager's World. We are building the most amazing hospitality network. Please visit our website, join us for free, and start participating.
Great. So here I have Anthony Paglino. Is that correct? Am I saying your name the same way that you do?
Anthony Paglino.
Okay. I met Anthony probably a couple years back in Miami. He was visiting, and it was quite surprising to me how much experience Anthony has, not just with traveling and couchsurfing, but with living in China. And Anthony, you also spent quite a bit of time in America, of course. You grew up in America, right?
Yes.
All right. So for the first time, I had someone that I could talk to that could really draw a comparison between those two worlds. And I'm very happy to have you here on our podcast now. So welcome, Anthony.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. And it's interesting that you bring up that time period, because it was a very unusual time for me, because I was undergoing reverse culture shock. So when I had met you back in 2012, I had just finished 4 years of living in China. Uh-huh. And when I first moved to China, I was 22 years old, still quite young. So in a sense, I had almost grown up in China as well. So I had to learn how to be an adult in China. So coming back to the US, I had to relearn how to be an adult in America.
Successfully, or how is that going?
It went very well. It was a very hard transition. Uh-huh. Both, you know, when you transition to another culture, yeah. It definitely, there's a lot of, how would I say, inertia. Mm-hmm. And actually, I had gone back to China for another year after that, in 2014 to 2015. Uh-huh. So I had come back, spent a year and a half in the U.S., went back to China, spent a year there, and came back. But I think for me, the goal for China was to figure out how to adapt. And right now, I'm positioning myself to be more globally available, as opposed to just being confined to China or to Asia.
But when you went to China for the first time, what was the purpose? Did you want to stay for that long, or it just happened that way?
The purpose was, well, it initially started out as a curiosity with their economic system. So I got my degree from the University of Florida in economics, and I spent a lot of my time studying how their model was different from our model. So that's kind of where it all started. And from there, it went to learning about their politics, to learning about their history, to learning about eventually the language. So the language was the last door that I opened, which opened up a whole new world of possibilities. Because once, you know, the language gives you the ability to access people. And that's where a lot of the real human, tangible stories are. And for me, stories is what helps me understand the world.
Yes. So in China, spending all that time, did you get really comfortable with the language, or was it enough to become fluent, or how easy it is for you now?
Well, right now it's you know, I've been probably learning Mandarin since 2007, so that's 9 years, I guess. Mm-hmm. And but it actually, you know, it doesn't matter how long you study it, it's how often you speak it. Mm-hmm. And I was living over there in China. At first I was in a place where nobody spoke English. And at that time I couldn't speak Chinese, so there was a lot of more body language happening. But over time, I ended up not just speaking the language, but thinking the language. And I think that's where you start to experience more internal changes in terms of how you interact or people, or mannerisms, or just kind of all those words add up to ideas. And those ideas in China may be different from ideas in the US or in other places in the world. So it was more about accepting a different worldview. Mm-hmm. And for a lot of people, it's very hard to do that. And I mean, that's evident by our by America's political system, how I guess polarized it is.
By a coincidence, I have done podcasts with two other guys that used to or are living in China right now. Mike Ote is there for about a year. I don't remember asking him specifically about fluency, but we talk about life in China. And I also interviewed Chris Rees. And Chris lived in and around China for a couple of years, I guess. And he's quite fluent, actually. So, but with them, I didn't have as much time as I had with you, like sitting down and specifically comparing the two cultures. And I think that brought up a few very interesting points. For example, I asked you to compare the food, not to compare American food with Chinese food, but I asked you to compare Chinese food with Chinese food in America. And what was your answer at that point?
Well, I can't remember what I said specifically, but I mean, right now, the Chinese food in America is very different just because of the access to ingredients. But it's also undergoing a change right now that's reflecting the new wave of immigrants to the U.S. So if you take a look at what was Chinese food like in the U.S. in the 30s, what was it like in the 70s, what is it like today, it's reflective of the immigration wave. Mm-hmm. So right now, with more affluent Chinese coming to the U.S., they're actually demanding better quality Chinese food. So luckily, most Americans are reaping the benefits of that, where you're getting fresher ingredients, you're getting more modern cooking styles. So while Chinese American food is completely different from Chinese food, it is improving.
Yeah, I remember you mentioned that they drink warm water. Was that the story? Because I compare some of the habits, like having the warm water instead of cold water. Can you explain to us what is it?
Sure. Yeah, so that's just ideas on holistic health, where cold water in Chinese culture is seen as being harmful for the body, whereas warm water is you know, it matches the internal body temperature. So in China, you want to keep your inner heat. You want to keep that that temperature up, because they fear if you get too cold inside, that's when you start having health issues. Let's say you break out with you get a pimple. Well, that could be traced back to, you know, what's happening on the inside with your inner heat. So they have a word, I think fa shao is to get a fever, which basically means to start a fire on the inside. So their word for fever is like to create a fire. Uh-huh. So, but you know, if it's a hot day and you just, you know, want to need some type of refreshment, and you walk into a restaurant, they'll serve you a scalding hot pot of water. But then again, now they have, you know, Coca-Cola has been in China for some time, so you can find, you know, cold beverages. But it's kind of funny in China, where you'll walk up to a little convenience store and there's a refrigerator, and your expectation is a cold beverage, and you open it up and the refrigerator isn't plugged in, and they're just using it for storage and display. Uh-huh. So I mean, those are little things on a daily basis that you definitely build up a resistance, but you have to just let go of that expectation. And
oh yeah, I have the same problem in Europe. I had to give up on ice. I thought, I can't find ice here. So,
I prefer drinking hot. I'm drinking tea right now. I prefer drinking hot water now. And that's just, you know, these changes happen, and they're mostly mental in terms of the resistance that you have built up in your mind.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. But you are a freak, you know, drinking hot tea.
Yeah, on a Miami morning.
Yes. Another curiosity I have is about cultural appropriation. Like a lot of Westerners, especially younger, and they tend to adopt symbols, right? So it goes from tattoos to, you know, to from funny to stupid, or even like T-shirts with Chinese symbols, and you know, and you cannot go to a yoga studio without seeing 10 different things in Chinese, and you know, that is all this this adoption of Chinese symbology and characters, and I wonder if the Chinese find that silly, or if in any way they joke about it, because I don't think the Chinese are just writing like water in their you know, in a tattoo. They are. I don't see them adopting things they don't understand the same way that Westerners do. And I'm talking about America, but also about other countries. Like in Brazil, I noticed the same thing. It's like a widespread adoration for what they call, for example, the Asian or the Eastern culture, the Eastern religion, that in general they have no clue what it is. They talk a lot about Chinese medicine. Oh, this is Chinese medicine, and it's great because of, but who knows? I don't know if it is good. No, I don't even know if the Chinese think it's good. So I would like you to help us draw some comparison about lifestyle and about the impression that Americans have about life in China that may be completely wrong, or maybe they are right. So can you help?
Yeah, well, in my daily experience, when I actually, when I'm in the US, I kind of don't really bring up my China time too much, just with average Americans, because it's almost like a conversation ender. Because if I bring it up, people don't know what to say or how to react, or maybe they'll ask a question, or they'll say, oh, well, I had a friend who visited Thailand last year. Well, no, most people don't have any sort of access or exposure to China on a more realistic basis. I mean, most people will just see some headlines, some smog, politics, whatever. So there isn't really any real information there, and I think it's there for a reason, because most people, or at least most Americans, don't really, that's not a high on their priority list. In terms of cultural appropriation or misappropriation, I see I do enjoy looking at American Chinese tattoos, like when, you know, they'll have something. A lot of times it's they've written somebody's name that they love in Chinese on their arm. So I'll see somebody's tattoo and I'll say, oh, who is Angelica? Like, oh, my ex-girlfriend. Okay, cool.
I wonder if they are even correct. Maybe someone said, oh yeah, I want to tattoo these, it says Angelica. And the tattoo artist actually wrote, you know, that the laundry is closed on Thursdays, you know, or something like that.
So I actually have one Chinese tattoo. I'll see if I can't get it here. I got this a couple years back. So that is, and also, like, my hair just naturally doesn't grow there. I didn't shave it. But anyways, this is the traditional character. If you can see,
yes.
If you can get in.
Yes.
On the inside, you have a character. So this is traditional Chinese. So the simplify character, they take out what's on the outside and they just leave this little guy on the inside here. But the traditional character on the outside, you can almost see like a door. This is on the outside. And then this little thing inside, it just means open. Beep, open. So that's the word open, right? But in Chinese, in modern Chinese, words, vocabulary words, are made up of two characters. So, for example, the word for happy in Chinese is, the literal translation is open heart. So to be happy, you have to open your heart. So I got this character just to remind me to keep my heart open and the happiness will follow. So I mean, for me, that makes sense. But
yes,
if
but
I show it to
I see a lot of people putting tattoos in general that don't make any sense to anybody, right? It's just like, oh, I'll put a star here, or I'll put a, you know, this
right.
is a symbol of whatever, that they don't know sometimes what this symbol actually means to people that use it, you know? Or they don't have a clear understanding or a clear definition of what it is to, what it means to themselves. You know, and that's the nature of most popular tattoos, you know. But I'm not talking just about tattoos. I'm also saying, for example, this, you cannot open Facebook with any day without seeing someone saying something about the superiority, that implies the superiority or the wisdom of Chinese medicine or Chinese nutrition or Chinese peace of mind, you know, like, or something related to that. And
it goes both ways.
Yeah.
In China, they will be like, you know, this this one mountain with this one leaf has all of these magical properties. Or so it's, even in China, there's a lot of misinformation about traditional Chinese medicine. So it's kind of funny because it goes both ways, where at the end of the day, it's just somebody trying to sell you something. So it's just marketing. But going back to that question about cultural misappropriation,
yeah.
On the other side of the Pacific, in China, you know, people adopt English names. They'll wear English T-shirts, and oftentimes the T-shirts with the English doesn't make any sense. You know, and hence the Chinglish.
Uh-huh.
So it kind of goes both ways, and I mean, I think it's good now that at least people are thinking about it, or at least there's some. I'd rather there be misinterest than no interest.
Uh-huh. Well, so. China was very closed, and by consequence, it was very mystical, right? It was a country that, until late 80s or early 90s, you know, airlines from other countries could not even fly in. You know, only Chinese airlines could fly in and out. The country was so isolated. And now it became this weird hybrid in which they have a very capitalist economy, but very communist politics, you know,
right.
or a mix. And Ukraine is like that too. I like to tell people, you know, Ukraine is a brutal capitalist economy now, without any safety net. It's a totally like right wing version of capitalism here. And very unregulated, crazily unregulated. But the politics are still Soviet. So they are gradually, very gradually transitioning out of the Soviet system. While the economy went much faster ahead. And I would say that in many aspects, it's a more purely capitalistic society than America is today. You know, I would say we have more socialist institutions in America than they have in Ukraine. You know, like we have more services. For example, a public library in America is something spectacular. You can go, they don't just have amazing books and it's so easy and you just walk in and, you know, and use it, and you have a quite protected privacy when you're using the computers. And by the way, they have computers for you to use and free Wi-Fi and all that, right? So in most cities in America, a public library is something quite amazing. For foreigners, they'll find it impressive. And it's a social program, right? You go to a library here, it's something, except for the ones that are in the universities, they are part of the universities, so they are very well equipped. But outside the universities, you're on your own, buddy. There are very few. They are poor and small, bureaucratic. You have to register, and you know, and that is all this bureaucracy just to be there and sit you already have to fill up paperwork that feels like you are adopting a child. It's very complicated. And the books are not that many. And forget about computers and Wi-Fi. You don't have any of it. So in many, it's just one example of how America is a, I would call it, a more regulated and softer capitalism. While our government is to the right of it. It's more conservative than the economy is, and here's the opposite. We are barely out of Russia here. So, in terms of influence and laws and culture, and it's not the same. So, when I ask about China, like I am, and I'm still going to ask a few more things. It's not with the intention of preparing myself to go. If that was the plan, okay, I'm going to China, maybe I wouldn't even ask much about it, because I like the surprise sometimes. But you're the only one guy, or now the second guy that I know, that has been in America as an adult. And has been in China as an adult. So I think you can draw a more honest and informed comparison than most people would be able to, and definitely you cannot do that remotely, over the internet. And a lot of times Chinese Chinese go to America, and just like we have a cultural shock, of course they are having their own cultural shock. And sometimes they are having their own difficulties. So it's difficult to ask them, to compare. But in what other ways is it dramatically different or dramatically similar to America?
Well, I think the dramatic differences are on the surface in terms of all the sensory stuff, the visuals, the smells, in terms of, it's a different geographical environment. Mm-hmm. But for me, the point of going to China was to better understand how we are all connected. Mm-hmm. So the goal in learning the language was to communicate with other people to understand their point of view. And, at the end of the day, everybody is, worried about their family, their job prospects, their quality of life. It all comes down to the same, basic fundamentals. You want to eat good food and be around people that you care about. I think some of the bigger cultural differences may depend on the education system. Definitely is more rigid. In terms of the Gaokao, which is basically the SAT equivalent, but with more pressure writing, because mm-hmm. you get to take it once. Well, you can take it once a year, and that kind of determines your future. But then again, I've met a lot of independent thinking Chinese who have basically chosen their own path, mm-hmm. and it's thing in the U.S. You can believe what are the social norms, you can abide by that. Basically be a tool for something else, or you can, I'm going to do it my way. And I met plenty of people in China who have done it their way, have succeeded.
Yes.
And those are the kinds of people that I tend to gravitate towards. And even here in the US, like my fellow Americans who are closed-minded or who have no interest in something outside of their front doors, I don't gel well with those people.
Yeah.
Just a perspective.
Do you feel in China them being similarly entrepreneurial and independent, or it is still a very collective society that still suppresses individuality, and then you have these freaks that we end up liking them, but are they too much of a minority, or it is spreading? It is normal.
Well, I think the reality is different over there in terms of it's a much harder environment to compete in. So the way to compete is not on an individual level, it's on a more of a collective group basis. So it's about the relationships that you can establish. It's about bring in to get a piece of the pie. Because if you're going at it alone, I mean, there's going to be so many roadblocks that you're going to have to rely on other people to help you get past that. So I think that's probably the biggest difference between the U.S. and China in terms of, in the U.S. on an individual merit basis, you can probably go farther. Whereas in China, it's more dependent on your connections.
So even from the beginning, you're already building teams and building network, no matter what you're going to do.
Right. And I mean, it's interesting because I spent the last year I was in China, I was in a very different setting from that previous 4 years. I was living in Shenzhen, which is the capitalist, it's the capitalist of capitalist cities in China. Just to give a brief background, Shenzhen is across the border from Hong Kong. It originally was just some, you know, small fishing outpost. But in the 1980s, Deng Xiaoping, who was the then head of the country, basically said, we're going to do opening up and reform. Shenzhen is going to be one of like the special economic zones. Uh-huh. And basically overnight, a lot of money and a lot of immigrants flooded into the city. And it's just, it's been growing quite rapidly for the past three decades. And that's the other, you know, that's kind of the... Shenzhen is what every other Chinese city wants to be. Shanghai is Chinese for is a Chinese city for Westerners, whereas Shenzhen is a Western city for Chinese, is how I kind of put it. But that's where Shenzhen is, where you have, you know, the electronics manufacturing, your iPhone comes from there. You know, most of the factories are in the Pearl River Delta, Guangzhou, Foshan, all that's kind of like linked together.
By the way, that reminds me of another thing, which I suspect is built on can be built on this prepackaged ideas. That is a lot of concern, serious concern, and dumb concern, and comedy made out of Apple making products in China, right? So they say, oh, and they talk about, you know, the suicide nets and the WorldCom factories and all that. So that is a certain public perception that the factory environment there is horrible, right? And that, you know, companies like Apple are evil companies, you know, stuff, all that kind of bullshit. But what it is the perception that Chinese have of it? You know, do they look at it as, wow, that's an opportunity up, or WorldCom and some other companies like that that are making the iPhones? Are they a step up for them, or do they think of it as just another sweatshop?
Yeah. So this is a really great point, and I'm going to try and go in depth here in terms of what I see as the transition that's happening in the Chinese economy, and how that will affect the global economy. So for a long time, you had rural migrants coming from the village to the city, and they would find factory jobs and, you know, making toys or apparel, whatever. Most of that money would be sent back to the village, where you would have the elders and the babies. Mm-hmm. So those factory jobs are now disappearing in terms of there's a couple of things happening. One is the wages aren't as high to attract the new labor pool. People coming out of college or the younger generation who have higher aspirations don't want to take a factory job. So the labor pool is shrinking, which means that the employers are going to have to pay more, and because you have, you know, since 2008, China is mainly a manufacturing and export economy. Because you've had a slump in global demand, they're not producing as much. So there's kind of like one side is the macroeconomic side of things. The other side is this aspirational thing, where now there's more tools available for young people to create their own business. And that's kind of what I was experiencing in Shenzhen, is this new I guess I wouldn't say necessarily renaissance, but it is an awakening of individuals in terms of what they can accomplish. So more, you know, people wanting to do technology companies, moving up the value chain, in terms of even manufacturing, going from making, you know, simple toys and other products to high-tech electronics. So that's a transition that China is going through right now. But I think the even bigger thing that's happening is after 2008, I think my generation, or I think in America, the idea that money can buy happiness has been disproved. And I think most people would agree with that, or at least in my age demographic. And China is now starting to learn that lesson in terms of their young millennial generation. You know, it's a culture of money worship over there, even more so than in the U.S. Like, you want to flaunt your wealth. Mm-hmm. But I think it's still there. But at least from what I saw in Shenzhen and with the youth population around China, they're more aspirational for something more meaningful than just money, which I think is probably the most hopeful sign.
Do they still look at Apple, specifically now using Apple as an example, do they still look at it as a step up compared to the rest of the manufacturing environment there? Do they perceive, I'm not talking about the reality, I'm talking about perception, do they mm-hmm. perceive working for, you know, to make iPhones and iPads as a better job than most other companies there, or do they think of it, oh, that's another sweatshop?
Well, I can't say for certain, because I haven't been to the Foxconn facilities. Mm-hmm. So Foxconn is the big, it's a Taiwanese company, but they do the manufacturing for like Apple's mm-hmm. Electronic line. So I mean, it compared to other factories, maybe. But at least now there's more choice, because I think the workers have more say in where, at least their personal choice, they have more options in terms of what's available to them. But the older generation, who, you know, the lower value factory jobs are gone, and what we're seeing now is the beginning of a reverse migration from the city back to the village. So I don't know what those, I mean, my personal opinion is that needs to happen. There needs to be more growth in the rural sector. Mm-hmm. So it's like, how do you decentralize the, because most of the manufacturing is done in the big city center. So how can you like break that up? Mm-hmm. Let's see, the other point I wanted to make was housing prices in second, third, and fourth tier cities are falling, which that's basically the one card in the house of cards. Like the Chinese economy is built off of this idea that housing prices are going to rise, mm-hmm. Which is exactly where the U.S. was in the 2000s. Mm-hmm. So I have a feeling that there's going to be a reckoning of sorts. And I mean, if anybody who's lived in China for some time, it's just in the back of your mind, it's like, when is it going to collapse, you know? Because it's a propped up economy in terms of mm-hmm. the what the government does to ensure its own survival. So the Communist Party exists because the economy is growing. So what happens when that economy isn't growing? So that's the big question.
China, as far as I understand, and I'm a moron, you know, I'm not teaching economy here, okay? So I can barely balance my own checkbook, but as far as I understand, yes, it is a very artificial environment in which regulation is not par. Well, even in industry, regulation is not par with technology and demand. Like a lot of the changes that Western companies were pressure to do in terms of treating people better, they had to go and impose that on their China suppliers or Asian suppliers in general. Not because those Asian suppliers wanted to do it, but because the American consumer or in the American political environment was demanding it. You know, so if the environment working in a factory can be tough, today in China, I wonder how much tougher it was in the past. I noticed that in Eastern Europe in general, even in IT companies, which are, in my mind, on the forefront of, development and being, nicer companies to be on. I have friends that work in IT here, and Jesus, I wouldn't want that job for, there is no way I would like to work in such an environment that is so old in its ways. Let me give you a comparison on that. Imagine that you could create a time machine and you travel to the past, to 100 years back, so 1916, and you pick up one dude over there, like a regular guy, out of school, middle class, and you bring him back to America in 2016, right? And then you show him a computer with the internet and Google and Wikipedia, and he cannot distinguish that from magic, okay? It would take him a lot of time to learn all the things that are, the stack of technologies and knowledge that would allow him to understand that. You show him a cell phone, and it's magic, right? Same with a car. Show him a Tesla today, and he will go like, wow, this the performance is incredible, right? It's an amazing car. But if you take him to a school, or to a factory, or to a prison, in all those three environments, he would feel at home. Like, he would see, oh, that's the way it was. Prisons didn't change much. We may have changed the way we treat the people in some standards of how to treat prisoners, but it's the same story. It's still cells. The buildings are the same. If you get a prison from 100 years ago and you add paint, you get a modern prison, right? So, yeah, they added computers and no motors to it, but that's it. If you look at a school from 100 years ago and a school today, it's the same hierarchical thing. It's still one guy that has these supervisors, that have these teachers, and then there are the students. And the students are at the bottom of the totem pole, right? Nothing changed. And you look at a factory, it's people doing the work and their supervisors, and then the supervisors are the supervisors, a few layers of that until you get to the guys that arrive in a Mercedes, and nothing changed.
So the answer to that is, when is the revolution for those three industries going to arrive?
I have an opinion. I don't have an answer, but I have an opinion. I think that it is arriving. It is, occasionally you find exceptions. You can look at the way the prison system is in Norway. It's something very different. You can look at some schools, like in America, in South America, in Europe. Amazing modern schools are popping up. Some of them rejecting the traditional educational curriculum, and being based on homeschooling or an alternative curriculum. But some of them are actually incorporating the regular curriculum into their formula. But they are amazing schools. They are just the minority still, right? And in most cases, they are expensive, right? They are very progressive, very well developed. But not all cases. I have been looking at schools, for example, that they are developing in Brazil that are as amazing and as advanced as you can imagine. Very democratic, very different than that old model. And they are public. They are for free. So it is happening. It's just minority. Companies, it's the same thing. We developed the corporate model on the military model, right? So it was a chain of command, a lot of people doing stuff, and the supervisors and the supervisors and the generals, right? So it was the same punishment and rewards you know, make sure that they take care of what time you start, what time you end, you know, and there will be, you know, punishments for being late, for not showing up. And also that old rule that whatever you do, they keep, if you do it well enough, they will promote you until you reach a point that you reach your level of incompetence. So if they promote you high enough, it gets to a certain point that you are not competent enough to the challenge of that moment. And then the only solution is the way out. So you need to then be kicked out. None of it makes any fucking sense, right? It's they are kicking you out when you have the most experience, you know, and the most, you know, baggage in the company. It's not democratic at all. So it's based on that model. And then you look at companies like, especially IT companies in America and some of them in Western Europe, their working model is very flexible. They are experimenting with, you know, a more democratic way of working, more freedom, instead of one major big office in the city center and making everybody drive for 2 hours to get there. They are creating this centralized small office, and you just go to whatever is the nearest to you. A lot of companies are implementing, you know, letting you work from home and, you know, negotiate your own salary. So all those models are being discussed today at Harvard. You know, they're being discussed at, you know, in Stanford, and you go to very modern companies, it is gradually becoming reality. I was reading recently about Virgin. Now I don't remember if it was Virgin Records or if it was the airline that was adopting a lot of these ideas as well. Best Buy in America, you know, is famous for that. A lot of companies, but they can only go so far. Look at Apple, all right? Very, very modern, ultra-developed company, right? You work for Apple in the Silicon Valley, you still have to drive 2 hours, get to a big building, sit on a cubicle, and you're going to send an email to a guy that is 10 meters away, right? You're still not going to talk to him. You are going to be still exchanging emails. I understand that in their case, they have a very complex need for security and secrecy. I get it. And it's more complicated to do that remotely. But even if you look at any other company, any other startups in America, their models are quite interesting.
So I wanted to kind of expand on where the corporate model is going. And so just recently, in the past few years, there's been a new technology that's become quite available called blockchain. So blockchain, yes, is the underlying foundation of how Bitcoin works. And I think most people are probably familiar with Bitcoin. At least they've heard the name before.
Yeah.
So Bitcoin is a way, it's a digital currency. And the one of the main innovations is that every transaction is stored in an open ledger. So there is, and everybody who is on the Bitcoin network has a copy of that ledger. So that's kind of the birth of, I guess, the new decentralized era. And Bitcoin was the first, and there were many other cryptocurrencies after that. And cryptography. So the other innovation that Bitcoin solved was the double spend problem. So if I have a digital good, how do I prove that I haven't given it to two people? Mm-hmm. So there is encryption to make sure that only gets spent once. Mm-hmm. So now we have this new tool. What can we build with it? And that's a question that another organization called the Ethereum organization is working to solve. So Ethereum is a software platform that helps you develop decentralized blockchain applications. So one of the applications is you can make your own money. And that money is directly tied to the the Ethereum that runs the network. So Ethereum is a currency in itself. The other thing that is available is what's called a distributed autonomous organization. So what that means is if you have a company, you have multiple positions with many different jobs, and each job has multiple tasks. Well, there's a way to break up each individual task and basically have a piece of code that represents that job. So that code can then be put together to run an organization autonomously. So let's say that I am running a manufacturing company. I get an order that comes in. So I have a software program that has accounts receivable, it's running invoice orders. It's basically doing the job that a human used to do, but is now being done by computer software. Mm. So this is, which is good because, you know, it takes away, you could equate it to the spinning Jenny, you know, hundreds of years ago, where it revolutionized textile manufacturing. So this is, you know, another giant leap forward, but it's a totally new ecosystem. It's a totally new way of looking at the world. But it's something that the sooner you get on board, the better it's going to be for you. And the analogy that I've been thinking about lately, and this is something that I picked up in college, was, you know, what happens when you transition systems? So we have an example back in the 1920s during the Great Depression. Most governments had their monetary system tied to the gold standard. So you only had as much money in circulation as how much gold you had in your reserve. The problem with that, though, is let's say you have a huge crash. Government needs to increase spending to make up for the lack of private spending. So you can't do that if you only have a certain amount of gold. So what they did was countries started going off the gold standard so that they could print their own money subsidize the economy. So we're seeing another transit. So the company or the countries that got off the gold standard sooner were able to recover sooner. So I guess for me, when I think to the future, you know, what happens when we have the next global crash? I mean, nothing has been solved since 2008. In fact, it's only, you know, Band-Aids at that, but it's only gotten worse.
I believe it got worse because we had an economy that was super concentrated in 2008, and it's even more concentrated today. So the banks were too big, and we had to bail them out at that time. They are bigger today. So it didn't get any better. But my thinking on Bitcoin, for example, is that no matter how far from ideal it is today, I think it has a much better potential simply because no country can control it. And that means no country can fuck it. That's what it really means. You know, if nobody, no individual country can stop it or fuck it or tax it or somehow control it, then it has the possibility of being more or of really being regulated in value by supply and demand. As long as the volume is really big and it's really spread more or less evenly all over the world, then that demand doesn't fluctuate wildly because our demand for things doesn't fluctuate. It fluctuates in one country when it's going on a crisis, fluctuates in one market. But if you look at everything together, of all the markets and all the products and all the values together, it's quite stable. So it has that potential.
2 points on that. The first is, Bitcoin, blockchain, Ethereum, it's in a very interesting transition period because it's going from theory to practice. Yeah. So what does it look like for people to be exchanging Bitcoins peer-to-peer? And what does it look like to have, you know, these autonomous corporations running? A lot of that is theory, and the code is being developed right now. So over the next few years, we're going to actually see that implemented in real life. Mm-hmm. Second point is 90% of Bitcoin's volume is traded in China. And the majority of the mining is done by these large mining operations in China. Mm-hmm. So the story that broke recently, you know, with the Panama Papers, and it's implicated a lot of Chinese businessmen and politicians, they're keeping that real, they're not letting that get into the Chinese internet ecosystem. Mm-hmm. So what happens with, you know, all the processing power for the Bitcoin network is the majority of it is happening within China. What happens if they really clamp down on the Great Firewall? What happens to the Bitcoin network there?
Yeah, before we let some confusion sink in, to make things clear, I understand what you mean by mining, but our listeners and our viewers may not have a clue what you're talking about. So please explain, in a way that even a dummy like me can understand, what is mining?
Right. Okay, so a Bitcoin is a digital asset, right? If I have a Bitcoin, it's on, I have a wallet. It's a digital wallet. So I send you a Bitcoin, and there has to be somebody who verifies that transaction. So there are computers around the world who are running the Bitcoin network, and their job is to compute that transaction. And the computer that does it the fastest gets a reward. They get a Bitcoin. And how the Bitcoin network works is there's already a set standard for how much Bitcoin gets rewarded. So there's an incentive for people to kind of support the network, to ensure that the network is safe. So that's what Bitcoin mining is. It's a computer that is processing transactions at a very fast rate. The fastest computer to process the transaction gets a Bitcoin.
So, in other words, a miner, or a mining.
It's a mining
operation. It can be running in your bathroom in a computer, right? It can be as long as it's a super fast system.
Within the Bitcoin community, there's a lot of debate, and this is kind of a crucial time for the Bitcoin and crypto community in terms of developing standards, because originally when there weren't that many people on the network, your computer didn't have to be that fast to get the rewards. But as the network has grown, you have to have higher powered computers. So maybe at the beginning you could have a computer in your bathroom, but now it's large like factories in China with the latest computers. But what's going to happen in the future is, like, let's say like 2 years from now, and it could be sooner, you buy a cell phone, and on the cell phone's motherboard is a, let's say it's a Bitcoin chip. And that Bitcoin chip is doing very small transactions for somebody else's phone. But what that means is your phone is passively earning very small amounts of Bitcoin, which then pays for its own usage. So if you need to surf the internet, you're not paying Amazon to host the system. Your Bitcoin wallet on your phone is paying for that. So eventually we have a situation basically becomes free because the network has reached a big enough scale that there is no shortage of computing power.
Yeah. I have some Bitcoin and I got the setup, you know, I went online, created the wallet and all that, transferred the Bitcoin. I just found it cumbersome to do it. The
yep.
same way
yes.
that connecting to the internet was cumbersome. I started really playing with the internet in 92, 93 or so. And I remember that in 98, I was making plenty of money in Miami, still setting up internet connections and networks and sharing the internet in offices, you know, setting up things like that, because it was still a pain in the ass to do it, right? And now you look at it 12 years later, it's, you know, more than 12, 14 years later, you look at it today, and internet connection is something you presume, you don't even think of it, right? You get anywhere and all you want is the password for the Wi-Fi. And you don't even think of all the steps to make that connect to the world, right? I believe that now Bitcoin is not 12 years away from being something that you just put an app on your phone and, okay, this is my money, right? And it's safe and it's, you know, it's something that is trustworthy and the hackers can try to break it but still cannot do it. So it's pretty safe. It's pretty good. At least as safe as banking is today, right?
Well, banking
is perceived. I don't think Bitcoin is far from it. I think they are very close. That we are maybe a year, 2 years away from having an environment of apps, and then the culture spreading just enough to reach that tipping point in which a consumer will consider, okay, on my phone I'll put WhatsApp and I'll put, you know, Facebook and I'll put this Bitcoin thing, you know, so I can receive and pay stuff. You know?
So I think one of the thing that's going to happen next is small and medium-sized businesses will probably switch to Bitcoin for advertising. And the reason why I say that is because right now, if you want to advertise, you're paying Google or you're paying Facebook to advertise online, right?
Yeah.
That money is not guaranteed to get you that that customer conversion. Mm-hmm. With Bitcoin, however, you can confirm any new customer with your Bitcoin advertising. So how that would work is, let's say I have a pizza joint, right? And I want to get customers. So what I'll do is I will, at my register, I will have an iBeacon with a Bitcoin bounty. So let's say that you come in for the first time, you scan the QR code, I'll give you $3 worth of free pizza for the first time. So you can have a verifiable saying, okay, this, you know, $3 worth of Bitcoin went to this customer. I have their contact info. I know that they came into the store and had a pizza, like, transaction verified. So what's going to happen is it's not necessarily a demand, but it's creating the technology easy enough so that people can walk in, open up an app, get their Bitcoin in their wallet, or whatever it is, because it may not be Bitcoin. Maybe in the future it's pizza coin. Mm-hmm. It doesn't necessarily matter. Just as long as you have enough of a network effect happening.
I think this entire Bitcoin is fascinating, and I decided to use it on Voyager's World. At some point, we are going to put a resource on the website, not yet, but in the near future, where people will be able to donate, you know, but it will be a completely voluntary thing. And among other, we'll give several ways to do it. You can put your credit card in, or you can send us money in the mail. I don't care how you do it. But one way that I want to do it is to accept Bitcoin donations in any amount. Because if you are doing a transaction on by credit card, for example, it doesn't make sense to do a transaction less than like $3 or something like that, but usually you do that like $5, $10 or whatever. But in Bitcoin, you can break it down into incredibly small amounts because there is no transaction cost. So I can ask people to donate or give us 1 cent, you know, and it still works. Not just allow people that have very little money to participate in the economy. You know, can you imagine if you have, if you can buy a dinner or you can make an order of something that is extremely small amount, or you can make a donation that is very small, it creates an entire new market. So we are going to get into it. We will be prepared for the Bitcoin world now, even though I understand that it may take a while for that to popularize.
But it'll happen sooner than people.
It will. I know it will. So I want to be ready early.
And it's also perfect for your situation because Bitcoin's first great application is cross-border transactions.
Yeah.
You know, Western Union will charge you 20% on that transaction, whereas Bitcoin is going to be a fraction of 1%.
Exactly. So, and what else have you been doing, man?
Well, the I've kind of been on this journey, as you know, for the last couple of years, and I think the time that I spent in rural China really changed my worldview in terms of how do we interact with each other and how do we interact with the planet. Mm-hmm. Because I think that probably the biggest existential crisis that my generation faces is a sustainable planet. And I mean, anybody with eyeballs can see that our current process is broken. And the question is, you know, how do we fix it? So there's a top-down model where you have, you know, the World Bank, or you have some international aid, or a government come and they, you know, spend money to try and fix the problem. But
they're all 20th century solutions, right?
Right, they are 20th century solutions. It's a 21st century problem. So I've been thinking about, you know, how do you empower people through food? And in the village, everybody's a farmer, and not just, you know, they're growing their own food, but food is kind of connecting the fabric of the community. So for me, it's, you know, how do you bring resiliency to communities? How do you bring a balance to our presence here on the planet? And everything, at least in terms of my experience, everything comes down to the water. So I spent some time while I was working in San Francisco at a company called the Urban Farmer Store that specializes in efficient irrigation. And that kind of started me on this path of understanding, you know, how does water work in an agricultural sense? And I've had a couple false starts, but I think like right now I'm actually have the right formula. Mm-hmm. And it basically is a way, what I've created is a way for you to capture rainwater that's stored. So rainwater falls on your roof, it goes down into your gutters and then back into the ground, right?
Yeah.
Well, it's really simple and very cheap, actually, to connect your gutter system to a rain storage tank. Yeah. And what I've done is I've taken a food grade 275 gallon cube. It's a dimensional cube that's about 4 feet by 4 feet by 4 feet. Mm-hmm. And that individual cube can store about 275 gallons of water. You can put two cubes together, you can stack them on top. But what this does is it gives a very cheap, economical, and reliable way for individual homes to store water. Mm-hmm. And if you look at how people access their water now, it's from a central distribution center, right? Well, there's problems with that because, one, you're not in control of that. You're not in control of something that is so elemental to everybody's existence. And you're relying on a government which may or may not have your best interests involved. And the best example currently is Flint, Michigan, where you have a broken political system, a broken resource system that leaves a lot of people hurting in the end. So, you know, it's not necessarily a top-down saying, okay, well, we're going to replace all the lead pipes. It's how do we go beyond the system?
Yes.
So rainwater is such a huge resource that is so underutilized.
I don't believe you're going to replace, to start from the mass scale thing. But there are so many markets and so many situations in which a decentralized solution makes more sense. So if someone lives in an island, someone is in an isolated part of Florida, your system may be much more economical and much more practical than to try to pull, you know, miles of pipes to have a
right.
faucet. Or in a third world country, or in places where regulation or some other environmental situation actually makes your system more practical. It's the same with using solar power. Solar power may not make sense economically in some points, but there are too many situations in which solar power is the best solution economically, even though you have to buy batteries, even though there are electronic systems necessary and the maintenance and all that, it's sophisticated. But in too many places, that's the best way. And what I when I look at ideas like what you're describing, I immediately I'm thinking already, oh shit, someone has a farm. I'm not talking about Africa. I'm talking about New York. Someone has a farm that is a few miles out, and it's a pain to bring water right there, right?
So I guess the question is, there's theory and then there's practice.
Yeah.
So how do I turn my theory into practice? The only way was to build a prototype of the system. Mm-hmm. So that's what I spent the month of March doing. I found, working through my local hackerspace, I was able to find a community of other like-minded people. And what we did was we, my best friend from high school, he and his wife have a house in St. Pete, Florida. They have a little backyard where, you know, they, it was just a lawn. So we went in there, we installed the rain cube, and then what we did from there was we connected that rain cube to a vegetable garden using drip irrigation. Mm-hmm. And connecting that irrigation is a small computer that basically takes in a couple of, it takes in some data and it controls a device. So for, and this is Internet of Things, just basic Internet of Things, we have a sensor that is basically telling us the water volume in the cube. We're also pulling in live weather data. So it's telling us when is it going to rain? Is it raining now? How much? And then we have a valve that turns on or off depending on when we need to water the garden. So, you know, for a couple $100, we've just retrofitted a house to become its own supplier of water and its own supplier of food. So that's on one individual house level. Mm-hmm. So if you zoom out and you say, wow, how many houses are in this neighborhood with empty backyards? And you'd say a majority of them.
Yes.
So what happens when, you know, everybody does the retrofit, everybody is growing their own food, and everybody is connected to the internet on the rain cube system, you start to have a localized food and water economy. So for me, it's not just connecting one house. It's how do you get an entire community working together and exchanging their, you know, their resources. So this is where the Bitcoin and Ethereum become really valuable, is because I can say every drop of water that comes into your rain cube, we can actually assign it a digital value. So that value, let's say you have for every tomato, for every ounce of tomatoes, it takes 8 gallons of water. So there is a direct correlation between the amount of water needed versus the food output. Mm-hmm. So I can, you know, how much water you have in your tank and how much water you're going to get over the year, how much food that can produce. So I can actually start to create an internal currency system. So this is what I'm, the long-term vision is to create something called Raincoin, so that every drop of water you can collect earns you a digital value that represents your physical value. So I think for, to take food to the next level or to take water to the next level, we have to take it beyond the limiting capabilities of our current monetary system.
This is fascinating. Is there a URL to,
yes,
to follow you on that? Send me the URL. I'll put that right here on the video.
And, yeah, it's
Raincoin. So people can keep an eye on it. And I definitely have I have a friend in Cincinnati. You can see his podcast. It's on Voyager's World already. His name is Robbie Ludlum. And he has been retrofitting the house to make it sustainable. But at every solution they try, they are measuring how much it really costs, if, you know, what is the impact, how to install, how to make it more efficient. You know, it's everything from the refrigerator to, you know, to the wind power. Everything that they are doing, they are doing carefully, keeping the cost extremely low. You know, so I think you should see that podcast and talk to him. You know, he's a fantastic guy with similar ideas.
So the other interesting aspect to RainCube is the ability to make it open source. So every house, every community, every climate is going to be a little different. So how do you create a platform that allows people to kind of bring their own solutions to the table? Mm-hmm. So I started with the prototype, and the system is run on an open source computer called the Raspberry Pi. Mm-hmm. Low, high power, and it basically allows a full computing system to be built for, you know, next to nothing.
Yeah.
So the next step is I have the prototype. So how do I turn that into an actual consumable product? So right now we're working on the industrial design so that people can actually order the kit from the RainCube website. And then they're able to adapt that kit to their specific environment. And right now it's just starting with vegetable gardens because that's the lowest hanging fruit. Mm-hmm. You don't need filtration. And it's actually, the system that I'm using right now is a gravity fed system, so there's no pump involved. But depending on, you know, if you have a flat surface or, you know, having a pump will be the next generation of the RainCube. So it's not just vegetables, but how do you adapt it to residential use for, you know, sinks and showers, and then eventually for potable water that you can drink. Yeah. And, you know, it's the biggest challenge isn't technical, it's actually cultural. So how do you convince somebody to say, give up your lawn and, you know, go to a RainCube system? So right now I'm trying to identify where are those locations in the world where people, it's not a choice, but a necessity. So right now I'm preparing for a trip down to Central America where I'll go to Guatemala, where there isn't a strong infrastructure and there's already a culture of rainwater harvesting. So it's actually easy for me because all I can go in there is with that little small computer mm-hmm. and say, pop it on, we're on the internet, and then see what you guys can create on top of that. And then from there, it's just how do you bring more people into the process?
Count on me to help promote this idea because I love this kind of thing. And I deal with, I have a project to build a boat in the future. And in a boat is a very restrictive environment. You need to be very careful with how you use every resource. So you were describing that, and I was already thinking, okay, for water for this, I can use that, and it can save the tank for the other thing. You know, like I was already imagining that.
And you have, and then for the sailboat, you already have those big sails, which has a huge surface area that can collect a lot of water.
Well, in a boat, water is plentiful. Because now the desalinizers are very efficient, so mm-hmm. I'll have plenty of electricity available, and I can make water, so that's not a problem. But that is like rainwater; it's not water that is excellent to drink because it doesn't have minerals on it, you know. Mm-hmm. So it's really it's like nearly distilled water, but it's good for everything else. It's good for cooking, for cleaning, for, you know, the shower, it's you know, so that solution already exists. But one thing that I don't have a solution for yet on the boat is management, a very efficient, nice way of thinking about water management, because that is custom. That is something that we'll have to take your experience and the experience of other people and develop little software solutions and little controllers, you know, to manage that automatically. Otherwise, it's a lot of pumping in, you know, in every direction to do and to manage.
And the other point that I wanted to make about the open source nature of it is it's not just software, but it's also hardware. Uh-huh. So most hardware companies will manufacture somewhere else, be it Mexico or China, and then they will have, you know, there's a lot of lead time, there's a lot of money that has to go up front, and it's not that efficient of a process. So with RainCube, what I'm doing is, from the beginning, is designing the system so that it can be manufactured anywhere and it can be installed anywhere. So if I have design files online that you can download and then use your local 3D printer to create a custom fitting for your little pipe, that is a much better solution than saying, we're going to have one product manufactured in China, and if anything goes wrong, our business model is screwed. Mm-hmm. So not only is it more resilient, but it also creates more jobs. So right now I'm trying to to get to a point where I'll be able to do pre-sales this fall and then basically get a local micro factory and potentially find some random people on Craigslist to help me fulfill the first order and then, you know, say, okay, we have this distributed manufacturing system. How do we grow it from here?
I love this. I love all this. And I believe it is modern thinking. It is very well inspired. And count on me to help connect to other people, you know, find the resources. And I hope you're going to use Voyager's World not just to help you with your travels, but also to connect to people that have this same interest. You know, we are creating a network that is not just for traveling and hospitality. It's to connect people that are, you know, like you, like Robbie, you know, like a lot of the people that are getting involved now, that they understand those things, they have an open mind, and they are resourceful. They have great networks where they can find what you need. So count on me. I would love to be, you know, to be a friendly force into that.
I appreciate that, Milton. Yeah. And I think for me, the whole goal of RainCube and why I'm doing this is to give tools for empowerment. So the idea that I'm trying to articulate is something I call the one drop revolution. Mm-hmm. And what that means is you can make a big impact on a small scale if we work together. Because, you know, one house with one RainCube doesn't amount to much, but, you know, entire neighborhoods, that actually has a much stronger ability. So we're all in this together.
That's excellent. Yeah, that's excellent. I'm very happy to hear that.
I'm really happy to connect with you after all these years because you showed me so much grace and generosity when you let me stay with you. Oh, and also, man. I mean, that was the most fun I've had in Miami. So,
no, we are happy to do, and I'm looking forward to meet you again in person one day. We are going to do another podcast with a follow up, and we'll talk about more stuff. And thank you so much. Thank you so much for being brilliant and fun, and for being with us on this.
Thank you so much.
All right, man.
We hope you like this podcast as much as we like to produce it. This has been made possible by the efforts of dozens of volunteers, supporters, partners, and visionaries that are helping us build Voyager's World. Please visit our website, join us for free, and start participating.